Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of Connect. I'm Adrian.
I'm Nick.
And today we have a special guest, Evan Wakefield from our SimpleLink wireless applications team, to talk a little bit about migrating from our transceiver solutions to our wireless SoCs. But maybe before we jump there, do you want to talk a little bit about our overall wireless offering? And I know we do have both transceivers and SoC solutions.
Yeah. So like you said, we have both transceivers and SoC solutions. In our transceiver line, we have the CC1101. It's probably the most famous of our devices. It's just a basic transceiver that developers can use to send and receive sub 1 gigahertz packets. Then we also have our wireless MCUs, which actually take that transceiver and couple that with a CPU, so you have the full capabilities of an SoC. You have lots of analog. There's a sensor controller on there, so you can do some low power measurements if you want and still communicate wirelessly with anything out there.
Cool. So kind of combining the application processor with the transceiver.
Absolutely. Yep. That's exactly right.
Awesome. Okay. And so why would somebody maybe want to switch? So say they're using a transceiver solution. They have two chips, the transceiver and a separate MCU. Why would they want to migrate from that two chip solution maybe to one of our newer wireless SoCs?
Yeah. Absolutely. So just to clarify, nobody has to move today. There's still advantages maybe to using a transceiver. It just depends on your solution. It's still a great product and we really enjoy it. Some of the advantages to moving to a wireless MCU might be improved receive sensitivity, improved range even. Transmit power might be better. Then you can talk about some of the things like current consumption, saving on board space, maybe your overall BOM cost could be lower potentially. So there's a number of advantages that somebody might want to consider when making that decision. Should we move to this wireless MCU? And then the next question is it time?
Gotcha. And I guess as a developer makes that decision, you know, they feel that this is the right step in their portfolio to make that step. Are there some considerations they need to keep in mind as they make that migration?
Yeah, absolutely. So as you can see up here, we have a number of considerations. This is really a very high level breakdown of what any proprietary engineer is working with. They're going to spend most of their time in application code, power management, the RF core drivers, and proprietary network stack.
And just really quick, before you go through some of those, can you explain kind of what you mean when you're talking about a proprietary versus a non-proprietary solution?
Yeah. So a proprietary solution is something that is in the 802.15.4 range in sub 1 space. There's also the 2.4 gigahertz space as well. But it's something that somebody has spent time developing on their own. It's unique to their application, it's unique to their end equipment that they're working on, whereas something that's more of a specification, you might be familiar with BLE, Bluetooth Low Energy, for instance, that would be considered a specification, or Zigbee would be considered a specification. So it's defined by a group that writes a specification for that particular protocol.
Can you kind of take us through those considerations that you outlined?
Yeah, absolutely. So first, with application code, it's going to matter where you're coming from and where you're going to. There's going to be some porting effort that's required. If you're coming from a device that has an ADC, doesn't have an ADC, and you're moving to a device that has an ADC and you all of a sudden want to leverage that, then you need to make those considerations. The same could be true for any hardware peripheral. You need to really understand the product that you're going to and understand what's available on that product. And for instance, on today's SimpleLink wireless MCUs, you can leverage the TI drivers, which are pre-built software drivers for you to get started with that application porting process. And then once you're there, you can take that code and you can compile it to different SimpleLink MCUs and use that if you want to add Wi-Fi to it or use it on maybe the MSP432 as well.
Gotcha. So I guess that's one of the benefits of moving into the SoC portfolio is that you have the ability to take advantage of the SimpleLink SDK.
Absolutely. Yeah. And the whole SimpleLink ecosystem. Yeah. The next thing that people want to consider is the RF drivers. Today, in a lot of proprietary systems, developers have to develop their own RF drivers that correspond to the transceiver that they're using. With our wireless MCUs, we actually provide those drivers. And those same drivers that we provide are actually used across a number of actual stacks that we support and release and are shipping today. In current projects and with current customers. So the same drivers that you would start developing on with the SimpleLink wireless MCU and a proprietary solution is the same drivers that we use in the TI 15.4 stack, the TI Bluetooth Low Energy stack, the TI Zigbee stack, and even some others.
Yeah, what it sounds like so far is by migrating to the SimpleLink platform, we provide a lot of the sort of fundamental building blocks where you can more focus on your application code instead of having to rebuild or reinvent the wheel, I guess.
Absolutely. Yeah. You can spend more time creating differentiation inside of your product instead of developing the low-level basic stuff that you need in the first place.
Yeah, and so your fourth consideration there, it makes sense to me that a proprietary customer could be starting from a number of different places, because when you say proprietary, they've built what they've built. Can you talk us through maybe the different starting points and how we address that?
Yeah. And so actually, there's a white paper that's available today that goes into a lot more depth in some of these considerations that are available today. But really, there's three main starting points that you could probably identify yourself if you're a proprietary engineer. The first place is that you may be just using a giant for loop, and you have some sort of low-level RF driver that you're calling, maybe in an interrupt-based solution, and just dynamically using that. It's just register-level C code. Maybe it's driver library code, but there's no sort of scheduler built inside of it. There's no RTOS. It's really just a one control loop that somebody would be using. The second one is if you've decided that's not going to suit our application. We need more than that, so we're going to develop our own scheduler. And that is a little bit more involved. It's probably a single-threaded system. You have that scheduler running. It'll time RF commands to be sent in a certain way. It's proprietary, so it's really up to you how you want to do that. But that's really where a lot of people put their secret sauce in these proprietary solutions. And then the third situation is if they're using an RTOS. Whether that's TI RTOS today or a third-party RTOS, we have some solutions for you as well.
And I guess, so the white paper kind of talks through those three starting points, and here's the path forward from there if you're looking to migrate.
Yeah, and you can find the white paper on ti.com/longrange and just see, go through that paper, really try to understand where do you identify, and then there's some actions that you can take to better learn where to go. And we've actually seen those actions work out pretty well with some current customers today. One customer in particular started off with that second category, so to speak, where they had their own proprietary scheduler. They ended up downloading the SDK, got the launch pad, and actually used SimpleLink Academy, which is this great training resource that we have with the SimpleLink SDK. And they just got started. They basically took their code from an applications MCU interfacing with a CC1101 and moved it over to the CC1310 in a matter of a couple weeks, and using some of the similar suggestions that we discussed in the white paper, and had a proof of concept working in just a matter of weeks. So it's pretty compelling. Yeah,
that's really cool. And what were some of the benefits that we're looking for as they migrated from a two chip to a one chip, this particular customer you're talking about?
Yeah, so the benefits in particular in this case was they wanted more integration. They wanted low power operation. With the transceivers, you have a certain amount of power, but you also have to take in consideration how much your base MCU, your applications MCU, is going to consume. And so as they integrated their solution together, they actually were able to save quite a bit of power and increase the battery life of their product.
Very cool. Yeah. Love it.
Yeah, that's great. Well, we certainly appreciate you joining. I know some of the key places you said to get started were ti.com/longrange. Mm-hmm. Your white paper's there. They can read through and kind of get the next steps. Is there anything else that they should look at as far as resources?
I would say SimpleLink Academy is pretty useful out there. Whether or not you're really interested in proprietary, or if you're looking to do something else, maybe you want to add to your proprietary network BLE stack capability and do some interoperability. There's some good SimpleLink Academies on the Dynamic Multi-Protocol Manager. You can really learn just about anything in SimpleLink Academy.
Yeah, great. Well, thank you so much for joining us, Evan. This was a really interesting talk. I know I enjoyed it. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Thank you for joining, as always. If you do have any feedback for us, any topics you'd like to see, you can tweet at us at @sensor2cloud. You can also visit ti.com/simplelink to get started on everything we talk about in this series. Don't miss next week. We have a really cool demo, so be sure to tune in. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, everyone.